Hey folks, just let some people get logged on here and join us. How you guys doing out there? Justin, how are you? I see you're out there. We'll start at 7, a couple more minutes. Anybody getting any weather anywhere? We're supposed to get rain down here pretty bad here in California in the next 24 hours. Looking forward to that. All right. Aaron, what's going on over there? We're getting your weather in about 4 or 5 hours. All right, I'm Alexi Sahagian, your host, Boost Power TV. We'll just let a few more people check in here and see if they can log on. I know there's a few more texting me trying to get on here. And we'll go back to answer some of the questions that were sent in during and at the end of last week's show and get into some other stuff that was written in and showed interest among other segments here at our shop. And we'll try to keep it 30 minutes or less, but that seems to never work. We always go over. So, give it a couple more minutes. All right, so there was a gentleman who asked us random questions about oxygen sensors. I know it's kind of not related to last week's show, but I wanted to explain, you know, a lot of people, you know, have different types of fuel injection systems in both their car and their boat, and they have two types of oxygen sensors that are common. So a lot of times they'll, you know, take their oxygen sensor out because of a code reading or whatever, and they'll go down to their hardware store, you know, this screws right in the same hole, and it also has the same plug. So what happens is, you know, they think it's the same, and really, it's not. They operate in different ranges and sensitivities and basically, in a nutshell, calibrations and ranges. So to keep it simple, make sure you buy the sensor that your EFI system is designed to be reading from and whatever your engine builder, provider, however, whatever that part number is. Because a lot of times, you know, like, for example, this is an NTK sensor, right? But like if you buy one from one brand, it has this plug on it. But on another brand, it also has this plug, but there's a resistor that they put in there because their EFI is calibrated to work with the resistor. So you can do a lot of damage if you don't have the right combination of the oxygen sensor and the manufacturer or provider for your EFI system. So you got to make sure that you check all those things because, again, these all look pretty much the same, but they could be different. There's a motorsports version of this sensor. There's a 4.9. There's several different feedback ratings and plugs. You know, there's different types of plugs. And, again, some manufacturers will put a resistor in here to make it work properly with their system. So make sure you check that. Something to look for. Very important to keep your fuel injection system running. All right, one more boring item. A guy wrote in and said, you know, every time I let my trim pump sit over the winter, it's, you know, I store my boat outside. He says, you know, I go to turn it on and it takes like, he's got to flick his switch and then all of a sudden it starts working. So what I was telling him is he could take the top of his trim pump apart, like you can see in there. There's this brush here and a brush there. If you simply just clean those, usually with a little eraser or contact cleaner or something, usually it'll clean or break off any moisture. And then you could flick that thing on and off and clean it, and it'll usually start working really well. But if they're worn out, these brushes are not easy to find at a local hardware store, but they are available. Instead of spending $650 or whatever it is in your area for this pump or motor, you might want to just have a spare set of those brushes and just take these four bolts off and do a little work inside here. Now, for some shops, they won't go through the headache of doing this because it takes the same amount of labor to replace the pump. So obviously, we'll suggest just get a new pump. But if you're a do-it-yourselfer, you can always just take this whole assembly apart and get any moisture out of it and inspect all the windings and just check it out. It's just an electric motor, okay? So have a good look inside and make sure you understand what it is. There's basically two brushes, an armature, and the thing spins around and it's basically got a ground, one polarity and another polarity that change the direction. All right? So I know that's not that exciting, but I promised somebody in Malta, of all places, who watches our show and also races boats, and I told him I would represent a cheat. A cheat is basically what some of these guys are doing in different motorsports to get more power out of their fuel-injected engine without being detected. So I figured I'd just throw it out there because a lot of people might be interested, but let's just say this is a 525 crank trigger assembly here with a pickup for the crank trigger, okay? This is mounted on the engine. This type of trigger, or similar trigger, this isn't exactly one, but it's very similar. This is a 58X wheel. You know, this goes by, and every time it goes by that sensor, it's pulsing this, sending a signal to the ECU saying, here's where I am in my 360 degrees of rotation, or 720, or however it's programmed to, you know, update. So in a lot of racing classes, you're not allowed to touch the computers. They're scanned, they're locked out, they have all these, you know, backdoor this and backdoor that. So they're what we call a sealed engine. Well, you know, you could put longer spark plugs in it to make it have a teeny bit more compression. You could put thinner head gaskets in it. All that you could probably get away with and no one would really know, right? But they use a tool called a whistler that detects swept volume and pressure, compression and all this, that, and the other. There are ways to do it. It just depends how hard they're looking. But one of the more difficult ways is if you take this sensor and you just shift it one way up or down on the reluctor. It's sticking to me. It's sticking because of the magnetism. But, you know, let's just say if you move it up, it changes it 10 degrees of timing, or down. Now, the computer doesn't know you're changing the timing. It just says, oh, you know, this is where we're at. And we're good, you know. But if you put a timing light on the motor, you just advance the timing 8 or 10 degrees. And that makes a big difference in a motor that's set up to be conservative at like 28 degrees. I won't mention any brands. But you racers know that some of those engines, they're detuned. So if you play with these triggers a little bit and a timing light, you could probably make some good power without even messing with an ECU. And then when someone scans your ECU, you may not even know that anything's been done. So I figured you know, it's a little bit of fun. Some guys are doing it, some guys aren't. All you inspectors out there, it's something to look for if you haven't before. But the only way you could detect this is if you plug in a timing light, look at a scan tool, and it says, I want 28 degrees of timing, and it better have 28 at that harmonic balancer. But you know, I mean, some teams will work really hard about moving the harmonic balancer mark 4 or 5 degrees one way or the other so it looks like it's correct on a timing light, but in reality, they've shifted the mark. So if an inspector was to look at it, so, you know, we get involved in finding those things by accident, right? We'll put an engine on the dyno and say, why is this thing working so well, or, right, you know, good or bad or whatever? So it's because that there's other people out there who have these ideas, and they take these things and they manipulate them to get the power without having to touch the ECU. And a lot of the guys, just for the heck of it, overseas, they don't have the ability maybe to tune the computer, and they don't want to ship them because it costs more to ship than the computer's worth. So, you know, we give them little tricks to increase power, especially because they have better fuel overseas usually, right? So they can get 93 octane right at the pump, and it makes for good good upgrades. So again, this is just the trigger, and it's telling the computer where in the cycle the crankshaft is to let it know how much timing or where it should be. So if you manipulate that, you can get more power out of your engine. And if you manipulate your marks on your harmonic balancer, you can also hide it or mask it pretty conveniently from an inspector. So that's the cheat of the night that I wanted to share with you. I get calls all the time on that. How do you do this? You know, can you go on the computer and make it to where it looks like you were never there? Sure, I can do anything, but you could do this yourself. That way I don't have to get involved in any of that. So, all right, so there was one other question that was related to throttle bodies. You guys have all seen throttle bodies. This particular one's a small Toyota one. So what this one is he asked, how do these drive-by-wire throttle bodies work? So this drive-by throttle body has a motor on it, and it's got a plug set that goes right into here. When you plug your plug set into here, the ECU sends signal into this throttle body to open and close the blade. So electronically, it's moving and manipulating this blade, open and closed. If there's an emergency, it'll default to a, you see how it shuts on its own. It's got a built-in fault control there. This actually is a Toyota Prius throttle body that was used to study in the Toyota Prius lawsuit. Believe it or not, it was sent here. So this throttle body here has a very, very neat, powerful motor. But what a lot of guys are doing now is they're taking the motors off of these or other brands, pulling it out and adapting it to the shafts of much larger throttle bodies. That way they can control something. This is very small, right? You'd need four of these on a marine engine, right? So, but the motor, believe it or not, is strong enough to manipulate two or three of the big blades in heavy-duty conditions. They're built pretty robust. So, again, they're very strong. They're fast, responsive, and a lot of the new aftermarket ECUs will control these. Check it out, because as far as docking goes in a boat, if you have a drive-by-wire setup set up right, it's like the best thing ever to drive. I mean, we have PWM and stepper idle air control motors, but nothing is better than being able to manipulate the throttle for cold start shifting. You don't have to have shift interrupt on your ignition. It's just really the future of boating and high performance aftermarket as well. So does anybody have any questions on any of that? I'm looking here down the list, several different things I can see part of. But if not, we can get back into that. So the other thing that we were talking about last week is oiling in general. So a lot of people have questions about oiling and how to oil and why it's important and where you put the oil. And so I wanted to show you like a couple things that are common issues on oil pumps and in general things to look for. So inside an oil pump, you know, you usually have two gears. If it's a dry sump and you have four stages, you might have four sets of these in a housing, you know, next to each other on a common rail or shaft like this. And if it's just a melling, like a regular pump in a small block Chevy or big blocks, just got two of these in a housing. Basically, they spin around and they move oil. So inside the pump, the clearance of all these gear meshes and the plates on the front and back all matter as to how much volume and how much pressure that the pump can handle or move. And the other side of that is how much resistance is on the other end. So you can have a pump that's set up to move, you know, X amount of gallons per minute. But if you have big bearing clearances, you're only gonna make 40 or 50 pounds. So you'll have to manipulate the springs, put restrictors in, do different things to make your oil pressure stay where you want it. There's some engines out there that they want to ramp the oil pressure up to 90 pounds, and then at wide open, they actually want to bring it back 20 pounds, you know, for maximum power. We do that on very few engines, but we have done it. As long as it's in a safe range, it actually works. But some people want the opposite. They want it really high at wide open throttle. And if it's a dragster, you know, they'll run 200 plus PSI. So it just depends on your bearing clearance, the oil, and the restriction of the oil system as it goes through. So a lot of times you'll see in the front of the camshafts or behind the camshafts in the engine block, you'll see pipe plugs with little holes in them. Well, they squirt oil onto the gear drive if there's a bearing on a double roller timing chain or on a chain system in general to A, lubricate it, but B, to cool it. In a marine application, you want to be able to cool that to keep it in order and never get hot, because you're running under load for long periods of time, and cooling is just as important as lubricating. So take a look and make sure, you know, that stuff's all in order, and try to understand. But the number one thing that we see is these little pickups that are in the oil pan. You know, a lot of times they'll breach a hole in the weld, they'll crack here, and all of a sudden they're sucking air into your oil pump. So you're getting aerated oil into your engine. And if you get aerated oil into your engine, it will still show oil pressure, but what will happen is you'll have less protection to the bearings, and then they'll start scoring up. If you look close, they'll start scoring up the bearing pretty good, right? Because it's getting oil, but it's not 100%, right? It's got a lot of air bubbles in it. So you don't want that. And then, you know, they press into the oil pump, but this particular one was pressed in and welded. But obviously the welder didn't know what he was doing, because look at it sheared right off, rotated, and fell out into the guy's oil pan just like that. So he went from 80 pounds of pressure to zero in no time. They didn't even have this bolt in to the pump. Had they had the bolt in, it might have just sucked air and blown up the motor anyway. But this was actually better, because it came off and it went to zero oil pressure, and that was it. The alarm went off, and believe it or not, it didn't do a whole lot of damage. But, you know, I don't like having these kind of pickups and pans. There's nothing wrong with them if you weld them and make sure that they can't breach air on the inlet side. But if they... A lot of times you don't know, unless you're running an engine and you continually pull that dipstick and look. If it's all bubbles, usually there's an issue with that pickup. And some oils will do it more and some oils will do it less, okay? So remember to check that on your oil systems. And then if you really want to upgrade, you can get a one-piece pump like this. So one-piece pumps like this, they have no oil pickup to break. It's all one piece. So this particular one is made for us, and it goes right in our pan, and it's a combination. This company makes several different length ones for stock applications. This particular one is for our marine. It's all one unit. It can't fall apart. In boats, when they bounce around, or off-road trucks, you know, you get a lot of vibration, and vacuum can, you know, suck air into those pickups, and you can have a lot of trouble with your bearings. So remember, when you're oiling an engine, you also need to pay attention to the bearing clearances and the other side of it, which is the basically any breaches in around a distributor O-ring, or any of the, like if you have a bad lifter that's bleeding off oil, all that affects pressure and volume where it goes into the engine. So if you look behind me, we have a V10 Viper engine over here on this side. I'm gonna try to move the, let me move the camera here so you guys can see better. And let me see if I can flip that. So if you look here, this particular engine has, you know, it's a lot longer than a regular engine. But if you look, this is the oil pump that goes inside the front cover, which bolts onto the front of the crank, which spins the pump, which is in here. So inside this pump area, there's a lot of modifications you can do to get this all aluminum engine to move a lot more oil via pressure, and depending again on bearing clearances. If your bearing clearances are too loose, then that pump won't do the job by itself. But if these are within spec and you modify that pump just right, then this all works, right? So it's really important to understand how the direction of the oil flows. You know, this particular motor, the thrust bearing is here, number three. So one, two, three, right? So this is your thrust. And the reluctor wheel for the triggers here on a Viper or any of the Ilmores, and the sensor is right there. So this is your crank trigger here, and depending on the year, there could be another one over here. So you have to make sure that you understand what it is you're working on to understand how and where you're going to add your oil or change your oil. You know, any of that oiling is critical. You got to understand them. It's like looking at a map. You have to know where that oil is going to go before you get on the road, and you know, you got to know where you're going. So you got to know where to put the path for the oil and understand what oil to use and the volume of you know, the pump and all that matters. But these engines are notorious for having oiling issues when you start upping the horsepower in them. So you have to make sure you understand and do some modifications to the galleys. And, you know, you'll see bearings in a motor and they have these slits in them, right? Some have two, some have one in the V10s. And some V8s have just one in the middle. Well, there's times where you'll see like half of this is open, or like the engine block is opened up and then someone's modified the bottom of the bearing right here. That's to get maximum oil volume and pressure around that crankshaft. So the more oil cushion you can put around that bearing, the better. But it does get to a point of diminishing returns if you have a gaping hole here and no support for the crank. So you got to really know how to calculate some of this stuff. But I want to give you guys at least an idea of some of the processes that people use. Now, if you look at these cam bearings, you've seen them in big block Chevy engines, and mainly this particular cam bearing brand has two holes, right? So, well, there's some engine blocks that only line up with one feed, right? So some guys might put it in and forget that there's not a groove cut above this. If there's no groove cut above this, you now have a cam bearing in there that's not getting any pressurized lubrication. It's just getting splash lubrication, so it won't last very long. I recommend that you line up the holes as best you can, or notch behind it to where it can have, you know, some kind of a way to lube. So, you know, it's the old story. You got to study whatever it is you're about to build. You look at a map before you get in a car and go. Hopefully, some people don't anymore, but you want to know where you're going with this, and then you can kind of see, okay, well, there's grooves here and I got a box of bearings. How do I line it up? You know, because again, you could put this engine together and all of a sudden it has 120 pounds of oil pressure and you're wondering why. Well, you're blocking that hole. If it's not lined up, it's just another hole that you're increasing the back pressure of the pump, and then the pump itself has a bypass valve inside of it, which are usually on these, they're in here, but you've seen the springs that go on the pumps. They just open and they're bypassing oil because they don't have a place to put it. So that can be bad, you know, for a lot of reasons. You can have great oil pressure, but you're not getting any volume to your main bearings. While we're talking about that, I want to show you one other thing that's pretty important to see. If you look at this engine here, this is a regular big block Chevy, like a Dart type block. But if you look, you see how they have bleeder holes, and you've seen these, all you builders out there, you've seen all these holes here that are drilled into these pipe plugs. They're designed to oil the back of the gear drive on this particular application. What happens though is if you have a regular oil pump in your pan, and you do this setup like this, you're gonna have such low oil pressure because you're bleeding it all off into the engine. I mean, that's an oil leak inside of the engine. So if you have an oil leak inside the engine, you're gonna have less oil pressure, and that could turn into a nightmare. So you gotta know, like that particular engine has an external giant, it's like a dry sump pump, but it's mounted on the timing cover, right? So that one, no problem. You just turn up the volume and you're good to go. But if it's an internal one like this, and you don't know ahead of time, you're going to have no oil pressure. It's going to have to start up and have 30 pounds and maybe 50 when you're running it, you know, up in the RPM range. So you got to make sure that you understand how oil works in the application that you're using it in, all right? You guys seen these little guys? These are the little oil bypass valves that you find inside of an engine block. Mainly the generation 5, 6, and some aftermarket engines, they have these underneath the oil filter. Well, these are designed for, like, if they're in the center, they're designed if you run an external oil cooler to keep the oil flow direction correct. Some claim that these hold oil up into the motor when you shut it off, which they do, but they do bleed off a little bit. But the problem is some of these on a high performance motor with 50 or 60 weight oil in it can be a problem if they're in the oil filter housing. The reason I say that is this is designed if there's a differential of pressure in the oil filter, for example, it will bypass. Well, if it bypasses, then it's not filtering and it's just taking raw oil, bypassing the filter and going into your engine. You don't want that. You need good oil flow and filtered oil going into your engine. So on high performance applications, we usually take these out and pipe plug the block. That way we are forcing and making sure all oil is going through a high performance filter. Now, if you have a stock filter, there's times where you can blow the element out. And if you blow the element out, the fuel filter just basically internally implodes and it just doesn't work properly. It actually has good oil pressure because it blew the paper into the other part of the can, but you gotta make sure that the oil pressure is set up properly. So I block these off and plug them in all applications that are high performance. To answer your question, David, we don't like them. In a stock application, they have their place because they're moving oil and changing direction of oil cooling and this, that, and the other. But you gotta make sure that you understand what it is you're doing and where you came from with that to make sure that you're not gonna screw it up. So keep in mind, that's a really important thing. All right, so real quick, a guy had a question about a starter. This is a pinion gear on a starter. He had a flywheel issue, so he had a shop change his flywheel, which is fine. A lot of times you can change the ring. I usually recommend the whole flywheel and then just maybe recycle the material. Unless you have a lot of time. I also recommend taking your starter off and just change the pinion gear. You know, because if you don't change this, it's like running a camshaft without a new distributor gear. It will re-break in and then you're going to have metal going through your system and it's not really good for anything. So you want to make sure that this stuff here is new so it wears in. Otherwise, what happens is this worn out gear from the starting of the bad flywheel, it'll just eventually beat up the new one, right? So either change your starter, or if you can buy a pinion gear at your local rebuilder, that'd be a simple change. It's just usually a pin or a clip and you swap it out. Again, some shops won't do it. They'll just change the starter because it costs more labor to swap this than the starter costs. And that might be the case where you're at. But either way, you want to start fresh with fresh gears meshing on each other, no matter what you do there, okay? Any other questions about any of that stuff? Before we go on, there's a couple more things I wanted to share tonight. I'm trying to see if I can. I can't quite see all the questions. It only shows two or three at a time here, and they just kind of bump through. But all right, well, so the oiling is a big deal. We talked about it last week. Bearing clearances have a lot to do with your oil pressure and keeping the engine's oil PSI in order. These grooves and different things that are incorporated into the modification of bearings or stock, they're designed to drain oil out. So again, there's a lot of little tricks that you could do or modify to manipulate where you want the oil on each type of bearing. There's old tricks of grooving bearings, modifying the block, taking a countersink to, chamfering the way the holes are in the crank. all that matters. It all adds up to all that adds up to a good setup if you know what it is. Justin, yes, we do like the Obergs. They're nice to have if you're going to actually inspect them. But what a lot of shops do is they change the oil filter on the motor, but they forget about or don't know about the Oberg that's in line in the system. And then it becomes a problem because it gets clogged over time. And then they think the motor's bad, but really just the Oberg screen's clogged. And it could be clogged with material that's not metal, you know, just TFE paste, rubber from braided hose. So if you have any extra filtration system, make sure you check it. Justin says, why don't you prefer just to change the flywheel ring gear? I don't mind doing it, but the time it takes to do that versus swapping the part and the cost effectiveness doesn't make sense usually. But if you don't do that process right and have a register or a jig for it to get on there perfectly square, then what's going to happen is it's going to grind every so often. You ever hear these starter? It'll sound like you never shimmed your starter. So, again, if like we do, we use a marble table, which is a perfectly flat surface. And then we heat it up, press it on, and then check it and make sure it's all square. But we only do it on a real expensive billet aluminum flywheel. It doesn't make sense to do it on some of the others. And then the steel billet flywheels, they have usually three or four rivets, screws, or some kind of indexing. And they just unbolt and you just heat them up. They're actually, to me, easier. But again, it's one of those things where the flywheel teeth, they can be chewed up a little bit or worn out anyway if you have a problem. But usually the actual circumference of the flywheel stays in good order. So we just recycle here. But again, it just depends on what your mechanic situation is or if you're doing it yourself. You know, just like this trim pump. I mean, a guy working on it himself has no problem changing these brushes, right? But if you're going to pay a shop to take your pump apart, it's probably the same cost to just R&R it. So you got to make some decisions there and decide if that's the best choice for your application. All right. So let's see. I wanted to show a couple guys. I don't know if they're still on, but a lot of people don't know much about these V10 Vipers. So I was going to give you a quick tour of them. They're an all aluminum block. This is a late generation one, about 2 years, 3 years old. And a lot of people don't know that they have no cam bearings. They ride on the actual virgin aluminum, right? All the way through the tube there. But you see the oiling holes? There's quite a few of them, right, in there? This is an older one that's coming apart to get gone through. But you can see it's worn in a little bit there. A couple spots have different markings. So overall, they're a long engine, right? V10. The other thing that this is where the oil pump goes, right? So there's modifications you can do. You see how the oil will enter this area? All that matters. All these little grooves have a lot to do with what's going on in this motor's oiling system because they've notoriously had issues on high performance applications. The other thing is the lifters as well. The lifters have no sleeves. They ride on the virgin aluminum. So if you look, they're all just virgin. So if you break a lifter, it's possible you have a junk block, right? I mean, we do bore and sleeve these with different materials, but sometimes it's not worth it. So that's how that is. These engines have knock sensors that are in the top side of the motor. It's kind of cool. And then your different type of sensors they use for cam sensors. They're pretty neat. You know, this one's a little bit upside down for you, but you get an idea how important oiling is on an all-aluminum V10 or an all-aluminum engine. You know, our 800 cubic inch engine's the same. Like, the lifters don't ride in the bores, but on our regular aluminum engines, they do. But one thing people don't realize is when you set up these Viper V10s or any aluminum block, I want you guys to look at something. Aluminum, steel, aluminum, steel. The main bearing is the same material all the way around. So when you're setting these things up, this gets hot at a different rate than this. So what happens is you have to really know what you're doing setting this and this bearing. If you don't do it right, then you're going to have a tighter clearance, say, here on the steel side and a looser one there, and you're going to have trouble. So you got to make sure that you understand the temperature difference and how it affects the bearing clearance here on the aluminum versus here on the steel. And that there is a science. So, but it is definitely the most overlooked thing in engine building with all aluminum blocks. You have to understand how that works. You know, sometimes you'll put an undersized bearing here and an oversized bearing there, or vice versa. It just depends on how your builder does his thing, you know? So, but you want to make sure that you understand that. We talked about this as the crank trigger, and it's in the middle of the engine. Kind of cool. And then everything in the back, like everything that seals this is one piece, right? So this whole front end right here, that whole front end basically bolts onto the motor, and it's the water pump, oil pump, and the whole modular front of the engine. And then as far as the back goes, you have this piece here that bolts on with the rear main, and then it kind of seals and creates a flange for the oil pan. This is an automotive engine that we're doing here, so obviously it has an automotive pan. But one of the mods that we do is where the pickup goes into the bottom of the pan here. It's really tight. So we take, we have a jig in our mill, and we'll bore a slot right underneath where the pickup is so more oil can get underneath the pickup to be able to have more oil flow. So that way there's no restriction. So these heads are prepped, but they're all CNC ported chambers. These are not, this is not like a twin turbo or anything crazy. This is just like a 750 horsepower version for the car that we do. But it's pretty neat. The cylinder heads work really good if you modify them. I'm not sure if you guys know, but the intake manifolds on these are plastic on the cars. We call them plastic, but they have a special name for it. And then the coil packs are neatly installed right on the valve covers, and makes it for a nice installation. So this came out of a late model car that we'll be putting it back into. Not sure if you guys have seen the camshafts, but they're pretty beefy. Look at these things. Again, oil control. Oil control is critical, right? And you see that right there? That's your cam trigger. Most people will never see this part. It's on the back side of the engine, basically lined up on the engine block with the cam trigger. So it's, this stuff's all pretty fixed, right? So when it's all fixed into one position, it makes it pretty cool, because it's pretty idiot proof when you're assembling it, right? As long as you put that cam sensor in the block and the one for the crank in the block, and you make that reluctor wheel is kind of part of the crank, you can't screw it up. The thing will start every single time. So when you start the engine, you don't have to worry about, oh man, is the distributor in right? Is the crank trigger gonna move? As long as you understand what we call crimp, which is the setup between the relationship between the trigger and the crank and the program and the ECU, these things fire right up. There's like a moron could put it together as far as that goes. Where when you have a regular carbureted motor, you gotta line up your distributor, get it right, make sure everything's in order on compression, and then once you do that, then they fire up and run. So there's a lot of neat things about some of the later generation designs of these engines. LS motors are similar to that, but you know, they have the trigger wheel on the outside front, and the cam trigger can be on the front timing cover or anywhere else on the engine, depending on how it's set up. And now there's so many options that you can virtually do anything. But the goal is to be able to have 8 coils and, you know, more cylinder control and resolution. So when a motor's spinning, you have the computer knows exactly where it is. Not like kind of where it is. It knows exactly where it is in its circle. So if it starts pinging on 30 degrees on cylinder whatever, it's going to catch it way faster than if it was an older system that had to wait till the engine went all the way around and pinged everything else until it got back. So that's basically kind of how it works, right? Now you're catching these knock events earlier, and that's a big, big deal. So that's kind of the story. Why not aluminum main caps? You know, they're just not as strong. But it is a good question, and it's interesting when you look at one like here behind me that's 50-50, right? I mean, that's steel, that's aluminum. That's how all the aluminum blocks are. But, you know, you look at some of the connecting rods out there, they have aluminum rods for dragsters because they're light, right? They're also 5 times the size of a regular rod. So, but, I mean, it's possible you could do it, but the distortion would be a lot higher, believe it or not. So, but that's an in-depth question, but it's a really good one. So we can look into that more and get into details. All right, so it's Tuesday night, Boost Power TV. We like to talk about things that are written into Boost Power TV at boostpower.com or Alexi at boostpower.com or boostpower at AOL.com. You can write in any questions. You can join us. We try to do it every Tuesday night. Sometimes we skip around. You can go back to YouTube or Facebook and watch some old videos. There's over 200 of them floating around. And if you have any questions, we'll be happy to answer it. Some of the stuff we talk about, we've touched on before, but maybe not in a way where someone understood it. So we like to repeat it. And we can get into anything, as you well know. So if you can, share it with your group of people. And thanks for watching. And we'll talk to you guys next week. Have a great night.